So this is the 3 o'clock hour, the witching hour. So thank you for making it. This is the difficult time in the schedule. We know that. And when I look at the crowd, I think, you know, you're itching for more slides, more PowerPoint for sure. So, and we're here to deliver. Hopefully it'll be of interest to you. And hopefully, even if you walk away with a little bit of perspective that you didn't have before, or some ideas or things that you hadn't thought of, that would be very good for us. So we want a couple of takeaways. My name is Matt Cauthorn. I'm the Vice President of Pre-Sales Engineering for Security and Cloud. And to my left is our esteemed CISO at ExtraHop Networks, Jeff Costlow. So we're gonna be co-presenting. He's doing the heavy lift, which is great for me. Okay, as much as I hate agenda slides, they made us do this. So we're gonna talk about what phoning home is and what the spectrum of risk really looks like here. And from a decidedly enterprise perspective here, we hear a lot about this data leakage and exfil of benign and not so benign circumstances in the consumer space. And here we're really focusing on the enterprise side because we believe it's quite underserved. We're also gonna talk about some real world stories and some real world experiences that we've actually seen with our own eyes, with our own solution out in the field. And most importantly, Jeff's gonna walk through a methodology to help assess the risk and understand the nature of these behaviors and how they comply or don't comply with your security practice and your operations. And then we're gonna talk about things to do from a vendor perspective and a vendor management perspective, being vendors ourselves, on how to perhaps level up some of the conversations there and get a better line of sight to what the nature of these systems are doing. So in the news, we see lots of stories about an Android app here, an iPhone app there that's leaking data, right? Sometimes it's doing so very deliberately with bad intentions. Other times it's doing it in a way that makes you feel a little bit squeamish. But the focus in the technical press for reasons that are pretty obvious, it's a much more sort of popular thing to do. We're not really focused on the enterprise. The enterprise is a lot less sexy if you're in the technical press and you want to actually publish something to the masses. We totally understand that. But for here, like, where is the enterprise represented? By show of hand, I always hate to do this because like, how many of you have, say, more than 10 tools, whether it's performance or security in your environment? More than 10? Yeah, that's everybody. Like, the average that we see, it's usually around 20 all in. And so you have this sort of shotgun blast of point solutions that are out there for that serve various different functions. And I would submit to you that a material percentage right now in your environments are actually exchanging data with the mothership. And so the question arises, what's happening there? Do you understand that? Do you understand where it's going? What the nature of that data is and how that maps to your risk practice? So a good way, in our opinion at least, a good way to think about this is as an extension of supply chain risk, really. Where many of you are familiar with, if any of you have ever used, say, I'll give an example on the software side, it installed a node module like React or something like that. The dependency tree is staggering. And it's very, very hierarchical and it's deeply, deeply nested. So at the top, the root node of this inverted tree is this green module, which gives you a semblance of functionality that you need to deliver your apps and services to your constituents. But then beneath that, you end up very quickly going into the red, where these dependencies, these deeply nested dependencies, are altogether opaque. And it's very, very difficult and almost altogether impractical to meaningfully assess the risk of these nested dependencies from a software perspective. And in fact, many of the vendors we've raised our hands here, many of the vendors are using some open source libraries at least, or others. And so this software model of supply chain risk really applies to the vendor landscape too. And for you on the enterprise side, as buyers and as users of these solutions, they too are part of your supply chain from a service delivery perspective. Not necessarily app delivery in all cases, but from a service delivery on the security teams. And so Jeff's got more information on this, but this is an example of some of the nested dependencies of a Chrome library and that was made its way into an enterprise and was actually monitoring some behaviors that were very, very suspicious, not necessarily flatly malware, but suspicious at the very least. So this is a very useful framework for it. Now, sorry. There are legitimate use cases for phoning home. I think this is self-evident. Back in my operational days, I still bear the mental scars of my ops days. We had a network attached storage vendor that pinned up an SSH connection out to the mothership, and it was very, very reliably and consistently beaconing data back that it collected about its runtime back. We understood the nature of this data very, very well. We knew where it was going. We knew when to expect that data to transfer. And so we felt like we understood its risk very well. And it fit nicely into our operational model. And so there was no problem. So there's many useful and legitimate use cases as vendors ourselves, things like license check-ins, software updates. And increasingly, and this is going to be one of the reasons why we believe this topic is so germane, is analytics or continually sort of push up into the cloud. Because to do meaningful analytics, especially machine learning at scale, it really needs to happen in the cloud, at cloud scale, to take advantage of the compute. And so now the burden falls on all of us collectively to understand the nature of the data that's being transferred. Here I could give some examples. We do cloud-based machine learning for network analytics and behavioral analysis in the NDR space specifically, but others are Palo, FireEye, Splunk Cloud, where we've got analytics happening in the cloud and your data is going there, or some representation of your data. And so this is an increasingly important topic. And what we see, and I've got some concrete examples later on where we're gonna talk about things that we've observed in the real world, and one of the common themes is that there's too little consent and reciprocity and open communication channels on between the vendor side and you as potential buyers. So to give you all a proactive line of sight to what's the nature of our data that we're transferring, what does our licensing mechanism look like, and what's the nature of the data that we send up to our machine learning service. So this is very, very relevant. It is going to increase in its relevance from now moving forward. So I'm going to hand it to Jeff and stand over here, who's going to walk you through some of the ways to think about the data.
Yeah, so as we thought about this, I thought, you know, my job as a CISO is to make sure that I'm keeping track of the data that we have. That's the other side of the coin, right? It's, as a vendor, we're doing various things, and I want to know. So we spent some time thinking about this, and I thought about some questions that you should ask, and we're going to go through a methodology a little bit later where I sort of formalize some of this out. But these are some of the things to look for as you start thinking about what data might be sent out. The first thing to think about is, what kind of data is that? Now, you can go way overboard on this. The US NIST standards 800-860 describes this in depth. The FIPS 199 standard is in even more depth. It goes into the criticality of at confidentiality, integrity, and availability, the criticality of all those. And you can go way complicated with this if you want to. I run a lot of threat models, I run a lot of things like that, and I find that unwieldy processes don't work nearly as well as I like them to. So I tend to just stick with high, medium, and low, and we'll see that later in the methodology. You should know whether this is EU or EU GDPR, or whether it's HIPAA data, because that should affect the criticality of the data. And then if you don't already have some sort of data classification policy in your shop, you really should have that. You should know what's going on. Let's pretend that somebody comes in and they're an endpoint vendor. It's kind of hard to argue that there's not some sort of high criticality data on all those endpoint agents that the data is going on. So understand what sort of data is going to be used in this case. Second of all, understand the volumetrically how much of that data is going to be transferred. There's a couple ways to think about this. You can think about, if there's very little data going out and a lot of data coming down, well, that's probably something like signature updates or software updates or something like that, that seems like that might be okay. On the other hand, if it's a lot of data going out, then you should worry about that, right? So think about how this data is, or where the data is going. And speaking of where the data is going, find out where the data is going. And this is something that you can fairly easily do. In this case, it's a little hard to see, but there's a little square around China in there. There's a big difference from your data domain policy and the agreements that you have with your customers where data will be processed. And that one might not be quite where you want it to be. There's a limited amount you can do here sometimes, but you, it's certainly good to know where this data is going, because you guaranteed you've got contractual obligations with your data. And then finally, another way to think about this is what protections are on that data? And these are easy questions. We ask these questions all the time. Encryption in transit, right? Is it using TLS 1.2? Is it using TLS 1.3? Or is it using really old crypto? Is there some sort of mitigating circumstance? There might be, it might be possible that there's like self-signed certificates in the mix or something like that, depending on the vendor. Ask them about encryption at rest. This matters as well. You want to make sure that your data is encrypted at rest. Do partners have access to the data? You might need to answer those questions. And then, and this is a big one, you know, figure out what sort of certifications, the vendor can prove to you what sort of protections they have once the data is at its landing spot. And this one is really near and dear to my heart. I spent a lot of time thinking about this a few years ago, thinking about de-identification strategies. These are enumerated in HIPAA, and you can read about them if you want to, but you can tokenize the data. If you tokenize the data or you truncate it, truncation is usually something like instead of being a birth date, maybe it's just the year, and that way you don't have as much information about it, and you've truncated the data. Hashing or encryption are obviously other things you can do with this, but this is a really, I really like this a lot because it sort of negates a lot of the value of the data, or maybe it doesn't depending on how you're doing it. Instead of having all that raw data up there, you've got some sort of derived form of it, and that may very well lower some of your liabilities. So we're going to give an example of a few real-world examples here.
But before I get into the real-world examples, if you've never had water out of a box, I highly recommend it. It's boxed water is better, so, okay. I've never had water out of a box before. It's a new experience for all of us. So we're going to get into some real-world examples. And this is stuff, look, as a behavioral analytics solution that sits on the network, we're connected to the connective tissue of the environment. So we see lots of behaviors present themselves in the field. And we'll walk through a few just very quickly. And then Jeff's going to get back into the meat of the matter and give you guys a line of sight to what to sort of how to quantify and think about this risk, or at least get more comfortable with how it aligns to your practice. So the first one is in the financial services sector, and many of you, all of you, should have endpoint solutions in your environment. Endpoint's extremely useful. And in this particular case, we had an endpoint vendor in POC, and the POC term had expired. And data was still moving off of the endpoints out into the cloud. Now, this isn't in and of itself, and look, from the enterprise vendor solution, we want to assume good faith, we want to assume best of intentions and things like that, but this became a real concern for the customer because they didn't expect this behavior to happen, nor was it sort of understood on the front end of this POC that this behavior was going to continue on. And from a vendor management perspective, I can tell you, being on both the customer side in my past and on the vendor side now, this practice of leaving POC systems running while things are in procurement or you're doing bake-offs and times have elapsed is very, very common, and it might run afoul of your, or it might at least be unpalatable for you from a risk perspective, all right? And by the way, from the recommended actions, again, you're going to see, I might take advantage of the, I won't do that. It'll be too mixed, the results. You're going to see lots of visibility into the egress traffic. We're going to emphasize this both from a geographic perspective, from a volumetric perspective, some of the attributes of properties that Jeff mentioned earlier. Second one is, this one actually happened out of band to the security team, which is where we usually work. We work with the SOC. There was another group in the health services sector that had brought on board some device management software, and the way this particular purchase, unbeknownst to the security team who hadn't vetted it or gotten a clear line of sight to this, it it actually presented as net new exfiltration behavior, and so it rang alarms, and it actually flagged detections from an exfiltration perspective. We just didn't see, nor did anyone know, that there was a purchase being made that happened, and we saw this solution beaconing data out very, very actively. And here too, again, it was an absolute surprise to the customer, and right away, because healthcare, if you're based in America, you know, this is obviously, in healthcare systems all over the world work differently with different regulations and constraints, but for these guys, it flagged some potential HIPAA concerns and, in fact, invoked a set of actions downstream to understand with the vendor and keep them honest about what was happening, because this wasn't proactively disclosed, and so this was a surprise behavior. This next one's my favorite. There was a team that grabbed some off-brand security cameras from an online, very prominent online marketplace. And there was, 50 or so of these things out there. And right away when these things we got the feeds and the network analytics were happening, we saw these cameras, all 30 of them, reaching out to a threat intelligence hit. It was a known bad IP for malware. So we saw these things reaching out to a known bad place, and whether or not you agree with the next part of the story, I'll let you decide, but one of the intrepid security analysts, we noticed that these things were listening. They had port 80 listeners for all of them, had port 80 open. So they had web servers, and so he just immediately fired up his laptop and hit port 80 on this thing. And it immediately prompted him to download and install an executable. Without any other, that was the first thing that happened. And so right away, the laptop closed, and these guys went and cleaned these things off of their network because they assumed that this was malicious behavior. And in fact, it turned out that, well, for convenience reasons as a buyer, I guess, the malware had been pre-installed on these cameras at the factory. So again, this is, and I talked about this earlier, where this is actually a spectrum of this phoning home behavior. There's a spectrum between like phoning home data leakage and then straight command and control or malware behavior, which is this is clearly the category here. Last one. And then I'm going to hand it back to Jeff. This is another security analytics solution that does machine learning. And over a two-week period of time or so, we noticed that there was about a terabyte of data being sent off campus, and in fact, out of the country. Here too, this was net new, surprise behavior. And what made this particular one worse, and I think that for the audience here, you know, this idea of data sovereignty can be a very, very relevant topic depending on where you are. I was in Australia last year, and data sovereignty was a big topic. And in fact, I was very impressed, if any of the Aussies are out there in the crowd, was very impressed with how top of mind this was. And you know, there was lots of questions being brought to us about data sovereignty. This was a US-based company, and the actual destination of the traffic, a terabyte worth, was going over to the UK, and that was not cool with them at all. And so this here too, understanding, and the potential, Graham Leach was the one, the potential risk in this particular case, also financial services. And so this data sovereignty issue comes up again, which gets back to a point that Jeff made earlier about knowing where this data goes, this phoning home. And then given the volume of that, a fair question would be, even after the fact, hopefully before the fact, but what's the nature of that data and what are you doing with it? Because the machine learning is supposed to happen on the system. And so now we're seeing all of this, a terabyte worth going off box. That's your data. So I'm gonna hand it back to Jeff now to talk about the methodology and the framework.
So as I said earlier, information security is something that I tend to worry about every now and then. So I wanted to quantify this sort of thing. I wanted to figure out some way to quantify my risk and understand the risk of all this. So I've run threat models. I tend to just kind of look at things in sort of a risk-based analysis. So I thought about this for a while, and this is mostly what we talked about before, but I kind of want to just be really clear on this, and then we'll assign high, medium, and low to all these. And I've got a few examples. So confidentiality. It's part of our triad, right? Is it encrypted properly? I mentioned a couple of these things. I want to make sure that we've got proper TLS on there, proper certificates, and make sure that I know where it's going. Speaking of know where it's going, the geolocation of the target actually matters. So let's worry about that. Let's think about that. Volumetric, we already spoke a little bit about the volumetric measurement of the data and how much is going out. I added this one in from before. I wanted to think about what sort of local peer devices are nearby that device and are talking to it. Because it's one thing to have a device that's just sending out a lot of data. Maybe that's a microphone or a camera or something like that. We've already spoken about some of the IP cameras. But what happens if it decides to go out and start talking to other devices and gathering data from them and then sending that back out? So there's definitely a factor there. And then the final one is sort of our data criticality. And we already spoke about this, the high, medium, or low in the data criticality. And what I neglected to tell you earlier is that in addition to my information security duties, I also run our threat research team. So I have the opportunity to get to play with some of these devices and sort of look at them. So that's what we're going to do here. So let's think about this for a little bit. And we're starting off pretty easy here. Let's just imagine a typical voice over IP phone. So I've assigned on the right-hand side there, we've got our high, medium, and low values. So let's explain this for a little while. Confidentiality out of a phone, you might be a little bit shocked to learn that some of that microphone data is not actually usually encrypted. So we assign a high to that. The target of the exfil, this one's probably okay. A lot of times you've already signed up with a voice over IP provider. You probably know what IP addresses it's okay to send that to. And very likely it's the same for all your phones. So you could look at all those phones and you could see that they're all talking to the same place. So I'm gonna qualify that as a kind of a low risk factor. Volumetric, once you look at these things for a little while, you realize that they've got some phone codecs and it seems to be they're all kind of static output. But I'm not gonna worry too much about that. They don't tend to have any local peer devices. Nobody tends to talk to a phone. So that seems to be a low risk there. And then data criticality, I do worry about somebody turning on a microphone in a conference room sometime and exfiltrating all that voice data. So I would qualify that as high. So I don't think most people would tend to argue with this. Usually when we get caught up in some threat models and things like that, it's when there's more grades than low, medium, or high or something. So I think this is a pretty good example. So let's take a look at kind of what this looks like. And I guess that's a little harder to see than I thought. But we're going to qualify this as sort of a medium risk, right? I can accept the medium risk of this. It tends to be very bursty. So in this, you can see the blue bar chart there. It's a nice, steady, what was it? It's about a one-hour phone call. That's what a phone call looks like. It's a bunch of RTP data, and then there's a little teeny bit of negotiation data on there. So we can look at this, and that looks normal. I can live with that, right? The very, very bottom there, you can see that there's only one, it's talking to one peer device, and that's okay. So it matches up with what we talked about. Let's worry about a malicious phone, right? Let's think about that for a little while. So again, it's not encrypted, so I'm gonna call that high. When it talks to somebody, it's not talking to my voice over IP provider, it's talking to somebody else. So I'm gonna qualify that as high as well. The volumetric, in this case, I'm gonna bump it up by one because I can see that it doesn't look like a phone call. It's on all the time and it's sending out a bunch of data. In this particular example, my threat research team was able to kind of own one of these phones and we were able to make it talk to other people. So it does have local peers. So we've jacked this up a little bit more and I'm getting a little bit more worried about it, as well as the unencrypted voice data. So here's a graph of the device that we did actually pwn. And I'm gonna have to describe this to you because it's a little hard to kind of figure out. But the purple thing over there on the left-hand side is where essentially we use Metasploit and set up a reverse shell. It's over port quad eights. And got a reverse shell on the phone. And then on the right-hand side there where it goes blue and goes for a little while, we just opened up the microphone and started essentially cat dev microphone out to over SSH is essentially what we did. Again, I don't think this is necessarily representative of what might happen, but I wanted to give you kind of a germane example and then kind of a worst case example. And as long as I was going, I thought this was a really neat exercise. So I kept going. And I went out and I bought a really cheap little IP camera. And I happen to believe, this is editorial here, but I happen to believe that if you buy an IP camera for $25 or something like that, they're probably figuring out other ways to monetize you because that can't possibly be something that they build and make any real margin on. So I took all my proper care. I put it over on a segmented LAN and all the things that you can think about. And I watched it for a little while just to see what it would do. Confidentiality, sure enough, none of that data was encrypted. Target of exfil, it did happen to be China. The volumetric was, I'll explain this in a second, very low but very constant data. So it was obviously calling back home and just sending out a few bytes at a time. It's probably more or less a here I am sort of thing. It did not have any peer devices, so that was good. It didn't seem to want to talk to anybody else for as long as I watched it. But then when I worry about the data criticality, yeah, it's got photos, it's got videos, it's got audio. It had all those features on it. So take a quick look at it. Now, what I did not show you here is when I connected to it with the little phone application or whatever, then all of a sudden it would go up and it would spike and I could see the data going out. But the important bit here is just had low grade constantly sending data out. I don't know what that was. I didn't bother to go in there and really take a look at it because I shut it off shortly after I proved what I wanted to prove out of it. But it was just an interesting little experiment to see what sort of data was coming out of this device. As long as I was at it, I kept going. I found a printer that I had had for a while. Now, this was better, right? It was clearly encrypted data. I could see that. I could also see that when it was exfiltrated, or the place it was sending it to was in the US. That made me feel better. Again, it was very low but constant data. It had peer devices in this case, right? My home devices would send a PDF to the printer or something like that. So I could tell that there were other people that were talking to it. It also had some MDNS traffic, so you could find it, things like that. And I would say that any sort of data that I go to print, I would put that in the high criticality of data. So again, let's kind of take a quick look at it. And it was just sending out a small amount of data over, that was actually an SSL encrypted thing. And so I figured that was probably just sort of sending its ink level or something like that. I wasn't going to worry about this. I think you can see the scale on the side. This is like bytes per second sort of thing. So it wasn't a lot of data. I'm curious what's in it. I haven't investigated this one further, but it's something we can do. This is the final one, and then we'll kind of go into kind of a general overview of kind of some more of these. A thermostat that I had at home, right? Most of these, you see these things all the time. Encrypted for almost all the data, but not all of it. And the interesting thing was I could see a couple of different streams in there. I'll show you a graphic of it in just a minute. You could see that it was obviously fetching weather data from, it wasn't weather.com, but it was something like that. And you could also see that it was also sending things to its home base. In both cases, that was US data centers, which was okay with me. Again, volumetrically, it was low, but constant outgoing. There were no local peers for it, so that's fine. Now, you can argue with me on this last one, right? Is that low data criticality? It knows when I'm home, it knows when I'm not home? I don't know. I'm gonna choose to call that low, but I think some people would probably call that high. We can work on that. So just kind of eyeballing this real quick, you'll see that there's at least a few different streams in there. We don't need to go into them. The other thing that was interesting about this one was I believe that I found a bug in that particular thing because one of the HTTP streams that it was constantly sending out was to a book service that's online that was constantly checking to see if some service was available. And it wasn't available anymore, and I think it might have just been an out-of-date piece of software. So it's kind of interesting that you can find bugs essentially by watching some of the traffic out there, which is kind of what we were talking about earlier. So I don't want to belabor this point. I kind of want to move on past here. But the point is, and I swapped axes here, so confidentiality of the data, the target of the data, the volume, the peer devices that it has, and the criticality of the data, I can come up with some formula that that derives a total risk to each and every device out there. And think about that in this category. And then you've kind of got a feeling for what you want to tackle first. Like in this case, I might go out and I might find a way to make sure those IP cameras that I had better control over those. Or maybe I'd use a different vendor or something like that. There's a lot of ways to control our risk in this. So, this is fun. I hope we have time for this. As long as we were working this out and sort of spending a lot of time on this, We wrote a few detections to look for some of these low-grade, kind of constantly data going out, and we spent some time looking for these sorts of things and discovered something. We discovered that there was some Chrome extensions in one of our labs, and it was sending data out constantly. And we thought about that, and we thought, well, what could possibly go wrong with a browser extension? Well, a lot, right? If you want to apply the matrix that we had earlier, we could do that. But essentially, browsers see everything, and it's after it's encrypted. So they've got everything right there. And then to make it even worse, a lot of that outbound traffic is probably indistinguishable from this normal traffic. So we messed around with this one for a little while. And essentially, what we found was classic symptoms of bad guy-ness, right? The Chrome browser extension was actually named after a rather useful tool that developers use called Postman. And Postman will help you use HTTP REST APIs and various things like that. This was named Postman, and it was a Chrome extension. And it sort of had a little bit of functionality, but it didn't really work very well. But what it was doing was every single URL that you would visit in your browser, it would send that out to what was, in effect, a hard-coded IP address in the code of the Chrome extension. And so I put on my CISO hat, and I emailed, actually, I think there's a reporting button, but I reported it to Google and said, hey, this thing is not doing what it should be doing. You guys should take a look at this. I also reported it to the ISP where the IP address was, and I said, you know, this is my data. This is data that's from inside my network. It contains possibly usernames. It contains possible all sorts of things it could contain. Please take this down. Well, long story short, eventually Google did take that down. It took a little while, but Google did take it down, and they have promised that they'll do a better job, and I haven't really been able to follow up on that in a while. So there were some interesting kind of lessons learned here. Obviously, traffic inspection can find interesting things, much less, you know, malicious browser behavior. For me, just thinking about sending those URLs is a security and privacy leak. And again, this was not something that I was too worried about based on where it was at in the lab, but still, you know, something to worry about. Finally, it was kind of hard to take that data down, right? The communications from the ISP, they didn't pay any attention to me. And then when we posted a blog post, Google took over, and then that was yanked down. So they did a good job then, and they removed it. But it's just an interesting lesson.
Hey, Jeff, I would put this in the supply chain category here, right? Because it was a developer laptop with good intentions, and is part of their job getting it done. By the way, a very common theme that comes up here is this was a name squat, but we also see typo squatting. We've seen this on the Python package index. We've also seen this in RubyGem world and others. So typo squatting or name squatting is a very, very common method for these people to sort of come in under a cloak of familiarity and by proxy trust.
Yep, absolutely. So let's wind things down here a little bit. Some of our conclusions from this. I just really like that little browser story because that was a pretty fun little week that we had there as we were messing with that. So some questions for vendors, you know, are these analytics that you're doing some data analysis, are they performed in the vendor environment, in the cloud, or are they performed elsewhere? These are important questions to ask. If the data is moved outside the customer, outside of your environment, what data is it? Does it include PII? Is it high criticality data? What are you going to do with it? Where are you going to put it? Are you compliant with applicable regulations? This is kind of the data domain, the data sovereignty question that we were talking about earlier. Tell us a little bit about your encryption. Are you doing the right thing to protect all this data in transit? Also, are you encrypting it when it's at rest? That leads to another thing that asks the question of certifications, SOC 2. There's a lot of these out there, FedRAMP. And then, is data commingled with other people? These are all important questions. We didn't really talk much about that in here, but that's an important thing to know. So some key learnings to take away from here today. IoT devices, they have data. They have interesting bits and pieces that you will want to know about, and it can definitely incur risk in your environment. The same thing applies to any sort of vendors that are coming into your environment and their devices that they're putting in your environment, so you'll want to pay attention to those. I I heart methodology, so I apply a risk methodology. You can use the one I have, or you can come up with your own way to do it. But high, medium, and low risk as applied to a few things will something that you can eminently throw in a spreadsheet, and it looks really cool to your boss, so try that out. Traffic inspection is probably the only way that I would have found some of these sorts of things. I'm pretty sure I wouldn't have found it based on Google Chrome logs, because I don't think I'd get those. So I wouldn't have found it that way. That's probably the only way I would have found this. And then we intertwine security and privacy all the time. This is a little bit of a soapbox here, but I do spend a lot of time worrying about some of the security and the privacy of the data, and I think those two are really intertwined. And when I assign risk categories, I didn't do it for this case, but I often assign a privacy risk to a lot of these, a lot of the data classifications that I do. So wrapping up, understand your context and your risk. I think we've kind of been through that. The risk methodology is an easy exercise to start to apply. It gets complicated as you go on, but it will help you out. Understand where your vendors are doing. Take a good inventory of your devices. I think you'd be really shocked at how many devices you have and what sort of data they're sending out. Don't deploy those IoT devices without some sort of risk assessment. Who's going to be looking at the data? What are they going to be doing with it? What have they done with it before? These sorts of things. And don't neglect the network as a source of this threat information. I think we tried to give a good example here of ways that we can see interesting things through that network information. And I will point out there that NetFlow is not nearly as well enriched as just sort of a generic good, a good source of information for the network. Do you have anything else to add to that, Matt?
Well, I mean, the thing that I would add just from a practice level, going back to the enterprise use cases and the vendor management side of it, is make it just standard operating procedure to ask proactively. Even if you think it's doubtful, ask your vendors if they're sending data off campus. If so, where, what's the nature of that? And all of a sudden, Jeff's framework falls in scope here. And you know, in all of the examples that I gave earlier, there was this surprise factor of, like, we just didn't expect these behaviors. And I would submit to you that this is absolutely the new norm. You know, I've got a Roku at home, and the thing is very, very chatty on the network, you know. And so this is the world that we're living in, and the vendor solutions are absolutely not immune to this sort of class of behaviors, because in many, many cases, it's value added. However, from a practice perspective, it's super useful for you to be able to understand A, rationalize B, and accept or decline these behaviors in your environments.
Yeah, be happy to take any questions. That's what we have. Is there any questions? The microphones will be turned on in a moment.
Yeah. Just a couple of questions. As an enterprise software vendor, we're really concerned about acting appropriately with this kind of thing. Your examples had a lot to do with device-based conversations.
Yep.
And so I'm just wondering, has the temperature from consumers, particularly enterprise software consumers, has it evolved to where that kind of phoning home, especially in the world of SaaS and Microsoft doing these kinds of things, is just the cost of doing business? Do you feel like that customers in general are okay with the things that you talked about as being okay?
I'll let Jeff go first, because he's a buyer and a customer, and so you're making decisions all the time.
So we see that all the time, and people come in, and those are the kind of questions I ask. I don't have a complicated questionnaire, but I do have some very pointed questions that I make sure that vendors are answering about what the data is. And then, honestly, the first thing I ask is, what data are they really going to have, right? If it's a marketing list, I may very well run afoul of GDPR. That matters, and the right to be forgotten, and some of those things. That seems to me to be a manageable risk for the amount of data that's going out there. On the other hand, I pointed out my data criticality levels that I have. If it is a customer data, which is pretty much off premises anyway, but if it is customer data or employee data, those are two things that I have severe obligation for, or I have certain obligations. And so I don't go very far with those. Those pretty stay pretty close to my chest.
Okay. And on the field side, it's really about transparency and disclosure and convincing your audience that you've really thought through the problem, and as we hope we have, and we take it very, very seriously, in demonstrating that and having documents and even sample data to provide in the case that it's needed, which is pretty common. And so, but with that aside, I think that the temperature is quite warm. People are open to it, but it's all about really the surprise factor and the transparency and disclosure, I would say, on the vendor side. Yeah.
Just one more question. You talked about exfil targets. You seem to think that US-based targets are all right. But what's to keep a bad guy from just taking the data to, sending the data to a US target and staging it there and sending it somewhere else?
I will fully admit that there is a lot of opacity there.
Yes.
When I played with that little camera, I could clearly see where it was going. However, on the other hand, if it had been sent first to an AWS data center or something in the US, clearly there's no opacity. I'm sorry. Clearly there is opacity there. I do not know where the data went from there.
Right.
Probably the only thing I can say there is Occam's razor may apply here, and they're unlikely to shuffle the data a whole bunch of different times unless they're Tor or something like that. There's certainly reasons for that, in which case I would probably be spending a lot of time worrying about what's happening. So certainly that's an issue. I think that has to fall into your risk categorization, and that's not something I can necessarily put a good handle on, but I think you can get a feel for it by kind of looking at where it's going. Yeah, good point, actually.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, so for the comment for kind of the room there, what is your expected target? I anticipated that, and I thought a little bit about it, saying, is it enough to just say US? And I finally decided that was a simplification, but I was just going to live with it. And so that's kind of what we went there. Obviously, there's a lot more subtle nuances to it, and we picked up on it.
Well, and your point stands, because this really does end up falling into now we're getting into sort of behavioral detection category. And so as you start to understand groups of assets and peers within the environment, you can now find outliers. And that's where the unexpected really manifests itself quickly. And your point totally stands. I completely agree with your assessment there.
Have you found yourself able to convince folks that essentially the value that you're adding by doing this kind of thing, or the value that any vendor is adding by doing this thing, is adding additional value for them, or does it mostly seem like it's adding value on the vendor side for them to be doing this, and that's why there are these sort of poorly disclosed instances? Corollary question, you used the phrases classic symptoms of bad guy-ness and yoinked, and I'm wondering if those are official technical terminology that's been resonating in the
yes
field.
And yes, they
yes,
are, totally.
Totally.
Yeah. I'll take that one first, and then I'm going to hand it back to you. And so on the pre-sales side, I do pre-sales engineering on the technical side. And so we're on the sharp end of the stick to demonstrate value. And so when this type of behavior, I'm going to go back to the 1 terabyte of data leaving. In that particular case, it was not clear at all that there was value being added there, because all of the behavioral analysis was supposed to have happened within the four walls of that vendor solution. And so if that is true, then why do we have a terabyte of data going out over a 2-week period of time to the UK? So this is a very, very open question. And that particular, I'm really glad you, because we sort of glossed right over this. This is a super important point, is that the vendor couldn't meaningfully demonstrate or explain why this behavior was happening, and they were sort of hand waving around it. And there was really never, this was interactive too, partially as well. So it wasn't just, it's another part of the story, but there was data leaving, and then there was interactive data. And so a lot of questions arose with no demonstrable value back to you all as buyers as to why this behavior was taking place. And so yes, that we should be on the sharp end of the stick to demonstrate to you and tell you why we're doing things the way we are, why we're approaching these problems the way we are, and convince you as a buyer that we've thought the problem through and we've done everything that we can to comply and not run afoul of your policies.
probably the only thing I would add to that is the risk calculation up front. And then it's always fun to go back and look and see, just kind of like we did with some of the graphs and charts. And those were very simplified. But being able to look at some of those, it's awfully easy. Matt mentioned interactivity. It's quite easy to detect when office hours are in certain places, because yeah. You'll see the traffic spike, you'll see it go back down after hours. So there's a lot of factors that kind of play into here as you start to look at the graphical representation of the various aspects of this stuff. So that, yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. Anything else? All right.
All right.
Well, thanks. Don't forget your boxed water, people. I highly recommend it. And we'll see you. Thank you.